The story of text means much, much more than just dancing with this imprinted bird. The breeding program for whooping cranes started in 1965 at Patuxent Wildlife Research Center. And that year they imported eggs from Canada, hatching eggs. And I think they hatched maybe a dozen whooping cranes. And that same year, Tex was hatched from the only pair in captivity. The reason she was so important is because her parents in captivity at the San Antonio Zoo were alive in the early 1950s when there were fewer than 30 whooping cranes. So genetically, this pair was very important. And they'd produced a number of eggs, more than 50 eggs, and some chicks had hatched, and they'd all had died in the pen because they didn't know how to breed whooping cranes at that time or look after them. The zoo director sort of took Tex from the parents and raised her for those first 6 weeks in his living room in a box. And then the government said, you have to send this bird to Patuxent to put with all these other nice whooping cranes from Canada. I did research there from 1968 through 1971, and I would observe this imprinted bird. And the researcher working with the whooping cranes was Dr. Cameron Kepler, and he and I had been students together at Cornell. So I agreed to work with Tex to see if we could get her to lay eggs. And he got the permits from the federal government, and in 1976 she arrived at the Crane Foundation. Spent a lot of time with her that first summer, and she really bonded. So I could be away for months and come back and she would still be fired up. So then I would work with her in the springtime every year. What daily life was like with Tex. I would arrive at her enclosure at about 5 o'clock in the morning before it was daylight and open the door, and we would walk together up to the top of the hill. And I would leap around doing deep knee bends and running with her, and it was actually quite exhausting. But it was sort of fun to wake up and to dance with a crane. And then she would solicit for mating. And then the two people that are going to do the insemination would appear at the edge of the field. I would turn her away from the door, facing in the opposite direction, stroke her back, she would elevate her tail, and they would run out the door of the shack and inseminate her. And they would let her chase them away. Then she would come back and she'd unison call, and she was successfully inseminated, and that's how we got Gee Whiz. All of Texas eggs were deformed. They were sort of wrinkled on the pointed end, and including the egg that became Gee Whiz. We put this egg with a very reliable pair of sandhill cranes, and for 2 weeks we never touched it. We just left it there. Then we had a real crisis moment. Was it fertile or not? And we took it up to the incubator room, turned all the lights out, turned on the candling machine. You hold the egg up to this bright light, and we could see there was an embryo. It was fertile. And then we weighed it, and we found that it was very, very much underweight. So we decided to keep it in an incubator and monitor its weight. And it was dehydrating very, very quickly because apparently the shell was too thin. And obviously the bird would soon die from dehydration in the egg. So we consulted with a wonderful physiologist, Dr. Bernie Wentworth from the Poultry Science Department at the University of Wisconsin. And he said, well, there's this new technique of getting antibiotics into duck eggs. If you incubate the eggs for a bit, and they're warm, and then you put them in freezing water, the liquid content of the egg contracts, and the atmospheric pressure will then drive water into the vacuum created through the constriction of the liquid contents. So we thought we're going to have to put her egg in ice water. And of course, the risk was killing the embryo. So we had this jar, beaker, and cold water and ice cubes, and put our precious egg in it. And we could see the egg moving around because the embryo is viable. And then we put it back in the incubator. And believe it or not, we were able to hydrate that egg and get it to start to gain weight. And then Gee Whiz hatched on day 28. But he was a very weak chick. And we had to help him out through the hatching process. And finally he emerged. It wouldn't eat or drink. It apparently, if it tried to drink, it would just spit out the water. And our theory was that the esophagus had been dehydrated and it was too small to let the water down. It was like stuck together or something. So the first day came and the chick is standing up and it's all dried off and it looks okay, but it's losing weight again. It's dehydrating out, and we knew it was only a matter of time because we could not get it to drink. And then what you do with chicks that won't eat is, what we do is tube feed them. We put a tiny tube down the throat and inject food into the stomach. We were hesitant to do that because we thought the tube, even although it's tiny, might rupture the esophagus and kill the bird just like that. But finally we had no choice, and we took the tiny, called cat tube, and we put oil on it and gently, just ever so gently, eased it down the throat of little Gee Whiz, and ever so gently, like 1 cc of life-giving fluid, and the bird just popped to life. But we were that close, both with the egg and with the chick, to losing it. Then we raised Gee Whiz with a group of red-crowned cranes, so he's not imprinted on humans. But we hand-raised these birds. They had no fear of humans. So when hand-raised cranes grow up, although they're imprinted in cranes, they have no fear of humans. And to this day, Gee Whiz has the record of being one of the nastiest cranes in Crane City. But we've produced a bunch of chicks from him, and he's well made it to his female whooping crane, unlike his mom. And I don't know how Johnny Carson heard about this story. After Gee Whiz hatched, I guess we had a lot of media. I was very nervous about going on the Johnny Carson show because I don't like being in the media. And I was concerned that they would try to make a fool out of us, because it was a pretty silly story after all.
You get teased about it a little bit, but this has to do with a 6-year-old crane, right?
15.
15.
Right.
And female.
Right.
And you were trying to get her to...
Right.
Reproduce, and we're not having any luck with it, so... No.
Well, government researchers at the Patuxent Wildlife Research Center in Maryland tried to breed this bird up until 1976. They had her paired with another crane, but this bird was reared at the San Antonio Zoo and was imprinted on people. She didn't see any cranes until it was too late. Cranes are precocial birds, and when they're very young, they fix or learn to associate with the moving object in their early environment.
Right.
So when I saw this bird in 1975...
And at the end of it, after showing these sequences from KSTP television, Johnny said, "I understand you have some bad news." And I says, "Yes, last night, just after I came to L.A., a pack of raccoons broke into Texas penning."
It's a very appropriate occasion. We've worked with Tex now for all these years.
That's the one we saw in the film with you.
Right. And we produced Gee Whiz on June 1st. And today Gee Whiz is a beautiful chick about a foot high who is perpetuating the genes of this very rare line. But last night, while I was on my way to California, Tex was killed by a predator.
You believe that? True story.
And so it's sort of...
Some animal got
surrealistic.
Loose. Yeah,
and
kind of sad.
It cut through the top of her pen and destroyed her. We have many cranes. We have more than 140 at the Crane Foundation, but the one bird, and it's the first time we've ever had this sort of problem, and it was her. But we feel that our work has been successful because her line is continued in Gee Whiz. And
22 million people saw that and learned about the whooping crane and the efforts that we took to help the whooping cranes. And I think very much that Tex was a metaphor for our whole effort here in helping the cranes of the world. That it's a roller coaster ride. The odds are against us in many cases. But if we stick with it and if we have faith, we're going to come through okay. And the cranes are going to come through okay. Saw that and learned about the whooping crane and the efforts that we took to help the whooping cranes. And I think very much that Tex was a metaphor for our whole effort here in helping the cranes of the world. That it's a roller coaster ride. The odds are against us in many cases. But if we stick with it and if we have faith, we're going to come through okay, and the cranes are going to come through okay.